All right, you're tuned in to Meet the Industry. My name is Jocelyn Vega, and today I have Justin Credible.
Jocelyn, what's up?
Fun fact, I went to Powerhouse. It was an amazing lineup, but I literally went to go see you and J. Cruz.
That's amazing. You told me that day, and I was like so honored. I'm like, you know, like Chris Brown is here and Kanye West, right? But that's awesome. Thank you. I'm glad we finally got to connect.
Tell me, what is a day in the life of Justin Credible?
It just really starts off like everyone else, Instagram and Twitter, right?
Our newspaper.
And Snapchat. But then like, you know, I definitely start like opening up emails, replying to people. A lot of music conversations start on the East Coast. So like,
oh wow,
you know, 7 a.m. here is 10 a.m. there. So. Right. It'll start piling in, and it's really like a lot of communication with record label people or other DJs, just seeing what music is working for them or how I'm feeling about certain songs. That's really how it starts. And then I come into Power around 11:30 every day, and because I'm also the imaging director here at Power.
Okay.
So that's like my day job. So I like, you know, create clean music, do promos, sweepers, show imaging, stuff like that. And I normally work, you know, in the imaging department all the way up till about like 5:30 or so. And then I'll try to like take a break, try to chill for a minute and start prepping, really, because I'm on the air at 7.
Yeah.
So it'll just be like a lot of prep from there, just going over like ideas of what we're going to talk about, topical topics of what happened that day, you know, like if Diddy is just fighting some football coach, we're talking about that, or Tyga just dropped a brand new album, like we're talking about that. And then 7 to 10, I'm on the air with Eric every single night, so it's pretty jam-packed. And then you know, after that, it's either a little bit of post-production on the show or jump into a club to DJ.
Tell me about your start into the music industry and how you knew that this was what you were going to do.
Right. For me, it was like I knew that music was my passion, like at a very early age. I loved sports and music and fashion. Those were like my favorite things growing up. And honestly, that's still my life right there, which I'm very blessed to say. But I guess in high school, when I started DJing like house parties and doing like some like school dances, I knew at that point that I wanted to be involved with music forever. I didn't necessarily like know that I was going to DJ on the radio, because that's like very far-fetched at that time.
Right.
But I knew like, damn, I hope I could work at a record label, or even honestly at that point it was like running a music store or something. Like, I just knew that I wanted to be around music. So I would say that was when like I first like started falling in love with music and like seeing how people would react to songs that I was playing. And that really like made me say, yeah, this is what I want to do forever. And then when I got out of high school, I started interning at a college radio station at Los Angeles Valley College in the Valley here. Right. And then from there, like, I started getting a couple little radio jobs and stuff like that. And that was really the time that I was like, yeah, this is what I want to do forever.
Damn. So there was, like, no plan B.
Man, no. I think about that all the time. Like, me and my friends here at the station talk about that all the time. Like, I wanted to be a lawyer. Like, that was, like, another dream of mine. And I can't do anything consistently except listen to music and DJ. So, like, going to school and all that, like, to become a lawyer, like, freaked me out. I don't know how I would have ever did that. So, I'm just so fortunate that, like, the chips really fell into place for me with this music stuff.
How do you feel coming into work every day thinking, damn, like, I made it?
Yeah, it's a blessing. It's a blessing for real. I get excited to come on that eighth floor every single day. The way that I got to Power was just like a lot of hard work. You know, I worked at a few other radio stations before getting to LA. And it's really crazy because you hear these things like, you just got to like work your way up the ladder. You just have to be like consistent every single day. And you have to just show everybody that you're down to work and whatever task. You know, you hear all these things that sound cliche, but I really did those things, like, without knowing that I would make it to Power. Like, it was just like, it was my, like, kind of like being in the military. Like, I'm gonna do this routine every day until someone opens the door, you know? And the reason I said that is because another thing that you'll hear that's like cliche is like people say like never burn any bridges along the way and like treat other people really good and stuff like that. And, you know, I think it was my second radio station that I worked for. My first radio station that I worked for was in Fresno. My second one was in Palm Springs.
Okay.
And when I was in Palm Springs, this is like in the year, in like 2000, Jeff Garcia had like a syndicated show. He had put his old school show out there. We were running his old school show in Palm Springs. I was like the board op for that show. I would like burn the CD and time it out and like get it ready. So that long story led to basically when I had the opportunity to audition for Power 106, Jeff was the same guy who handed my demo to my boss. You know what I mean? And it's like just crazy because I didn't know at that time.
It all lined up.
I didn't know. And Jeff was so awesome. Like, he gave some great praise for me. And and he just knew me off of helping him when he was in Palm Springs. So, you know, that was some of the steps that it took to get to Power.
Looking back at it now, like, what do you wish you would have known or someone would have warned you about this industry?
There's been many times where I was like, man, if that's what this is about, like, I don't want to be down. It's just like really compromising at times, or it feels like it's compromising at times to like who you are, or who your parents raised or whatever. Mm-hmm. And you just have to be like mentally tough. Like, you just have to know what you want and keep at it no matter who tells you you can or can't do it. Or, I mean, maybe they just are saying you can't do it right now. You know what I mean? You just have to be really mentally tough. And that was something for me that like has been difficult because it's always like, man, I'm a nice guy. You're a nice girl. Like, you treat people well. What the hell? Why does it not come back sometimes? And it's not necessarily people like trying to hold you back. Sometimes the timing just isn't right. But you have to be mentally strong to go, okay, let me be patient for another 3-4 months, another 6 months, another year. Because it's like a test from the man above. And it's like, if you could like stay at it, then maybe he'll open that door. You know what I mean? Right. So that's like one of the tough, and I'm still learning that lesson. Like, still, like, I still go through it where I'm like, I just don't get it. But that's one thing that I wasn't prepared for. Mm-hmm. And it's taken me a lot of like falling down to get back up that I wish I would have kind of had a warning on.
Like, just so you know.
Yeah, right? Like, just so you know, you're going to get knocked down a bunch of times. But just get your little skinny ass up, you know?
But I noticed that you also keep like very positive people around you.
Yes.
And your Instagram, really, it's kind of a reflection of who you are for the most part.
Thank you.
And I feel like every post, you never post anything negative.
Right.
If anything, you're praising someone or your posts are really positive, which you don't really see because it's usually just, you know, popping bottles and ass. But I like that you know, change it up.
Thank you. Yeah, I just, that's like one of those outlets where I feel like I said earlier, like you could totally be yourself and people could really see who you are. And yeah, those qualities that you grew up living, your parents raised you a certain way or whatever, and those are real values that I believe in, positivity and surrounding myself with those kind of people. And like, sometimes you go on the radio or people will see a club picture and they'll get a different perception of you. And I'm not mad at that because I love to party and drink and have a good time with my family too, but like, that's like a direct way for people to see like who I really am, you know what I mean? And Instagram is one of my favorite places to just spread that like energy.
Yeah, shout out to your mama.
My mama, she is like at times the embarrassingly loving mom, but
I love it.
I am the most fortunate son of all time because she like supports me so much.
That's amazing. Yeah. Usually parents don't really understand that.
Yes, that's true. That's true. I have a lot of friends that I talk to and like we go through that too because that's another challenge that like they don't get it at first.
Yeah.
You know, they're like, what are you doing? Like, why are you doing this for free?
Yeah.
Or what do you mean? Like, I have friends that graduated college and it's like, you mean you're a board op? And like, I hate when I hear that stuff. I will never talk to my children like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I get it. I understand. Like, they don't really understand.
They don't.
The vision and the dream all the time. But man, stay at it because when you do get to your place, they're gonna understand, you know?
it's funny because my mom was like, wait, I don't get, why are you staying out so late?
Right.
And now she's like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
You go out, you do your thing.
Right. Yeah. It takes a little bit of time. It takes a little bit of time. But for me, it was like, as soon as I stopped asking my dad for help with the rent money or begging him to buy me groceries, he then was like, okay, whatever he's doing is working. So keep doing that. You know?
Let's get more into the DJing of this.
Yeah.
Do you still get nervous when you DJ?
I do.
Really?
I do. Yeah. I mean, not all the time, you know, but but like radio still makes me nervous, you know what I mean? Because it's like you're in a room and then there's like all these people listening.
Right.
So like that makes me nervous when I start to overthink that.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's like certain venues that I'll DJ at that are like are big looks for me that I'm like, damn, I never imagined I would be here. And then you hype yourself up, and then when you finally get there and there's 4,000 people in front of you just like staring up there like waiting for you to make them dance, I mean, yeah, you get nervous.
Do you have any like rituals, something you do before you get on stage?
I mean, I do keep like my friends around, like I try to bring people with me because that makes me comfortable. I go through my set. You know, I like research the music so that I'm super on point when I go up there. Nothing like, no weird rituals or anything. Like, I don't wear my shirt inside out or anything like that. But like,
don't lie.
It just like, I just do have like a kind of like a calm and a zone that I have to get into because I'm naturally kind of like nervous. Mm-hmm. And it's like, for me, just like if I'm calm and my boys are there or like I said, I've done the research, that puts me at a calm to where I could perform the
You're
best.
Like, all right, I'm good, I'm
yeah,
good.
Yeah, right.
So I always ask this question because I feel like there's always a point where you're like, damn, I made it.
You know, I'm going on like 3 years of being on every single night at Power.
Damn.
That, like, every time that new year hits, I'm like, damn, like, this is special, you know, like, this is like the farthest of the dream for me. Like just working at Power, like seriously, like if I was a janitor at Power, like that was like enough for me, like for real, like and a couple other people who work up here. So to have the chance to do it every single night, like I guess in a sense that makes me say like, damn, I'm doing good. Like I did good, you know? So yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, at the top of the year when you're like, okay, I'm still in control and I'm still on at night. Like, I guess that makes me feel like I've done well. And also, you know, traveling and I'll get a chance to like DJ at, you know, whether it's like Tao in Las Vegas or
no
Playhouse in Hollywood. Like, that'll make me say like, all right. I mean, I know I'm on the right path, you know?
What was that feeling like when you're driving in Hollywood and you see your billboard?
It's crazy. It's
like,
so crazy.
I get goosebumps for you. That's amazing. Like,
thank you.
You have a billboard, and it's not just in the middle of nowhere. It's right. In Hollywood.
Hollywood and Vine.
Yeah.
I know. I'm like, people travel all across the country to come to, like, Hollywood Boulevard, and then I have this billboard. It's like, it's surreal. It's like, it's really like a tripped out feeling for me because, again, that's like the greatest of the, like, dream. Like, that's a real dream. Like, man,
those are my goals. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, like, one day I'm going to be on that billboard. And, you know, we say it. Sometimes we believe it. Other times it just seems so far fetched. But when I really look up and see it, I'm just like, I'm just thankful. I'm happy. It inspires me, and I hope it inspires other people.
Oh, yeah.
'Cause for real, it's like that. If I could do that, anybody could do that, because I worked my ass off to get that to happen, and it's just like a complete blessing.
So what does it mean to be part of Scam Artist?
That's another really dope honor and privilege, because Scam Artist is a roster of amazing DJs, amazing talent, like my from people that I work with to peers and like DJs that I've looked up to growing up. It's just a complete blessing to be on that roster, and it's really dope too, because you're always challenged, you're always learning, you know. It's like I could just go to like Vice's Club or Eric Deluxe's Club or Chalk's Club or Sour Milk's Club or whatever it is, or or listen to Syph do a set or whatever the location is.
Right.
And you're just always learning. It's like these are the best of the best DJs. So it's really dope to be a part of that team.
What was that turning point where you became kind of more known and more recognized?
I guess for me, it was like, yeah, it was Instagram, it was Twitter, it was LALeakers.com. It was a lot of viral stuff that I would do that would get pushed out through those channels, and then people would start to go, oh, okay, he DJs at Power, or I saw him in that club. I think that's really where it like started for me.
You created LA Leakers with Sour Milk, right?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So for those that are not too familiar with it, it's LALeakers.com.
Right,
can you tell us a little bit about what that has on your mixes and all that?
Yeah, so LALeakers.com, I mean, we pretty much debut and premiere as much new music as possible. Mm-hmm. Like that's where it starts for us.
Okay.
I mean, it's grown into really like a pop culture website.
Right.
But the root of it is like a platform for new artists and new music from other artists. So from new music from artists that are already have been established. So when you go to LALeakers.com, you will find my mixes, Sour Milk's mixes. You will find our interviews. You know, we just did an interview with Dom Kennedy.
Oh, I love him.
He's the man, right? Vince Staples. You know, our interviews, all of our content is up there, along with exclusive material from other artists, like, you know, if Meek Mill just put out something or Drake. So it's really like just a platform and a melting pot
for all music,
for all new hip-hop and R&B.
Who's your favorite rapper
of all time? Jay-Z.
You know what? I feel like I could tell.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's he's definitely my favorite rapper.
What about number two? Is there a number two?
Yeah, I mean, it's probably, I mean, there's a long list. Like, of course I like Biggie, of course I like Nas, of course I like Tupac. But I think that have affected me the most, I mean, I would say Jay-Z, Kanye West, and Drake are probably the top three for me that have, like, their music. You know, you have a connection with music. That's the most beautiful thing. And those three artists right there have just, like, moved me in amazing ways and inspired me. So that's my top three.
I have a question, because I feel like with every job that has to do with personality, you kind of always have to be happy, or you always have to be a certain way.
Right.
And when you're DJing, I feel like people don't just hire you because you DJ.
That's right.
I feel like you build that ambiance, you have that vibe. Like,
right.
How do you, are there ever times where you're like not feeling it?
Yeah, I mean, there's time, you know, it could be a bad day, or it could just really be like, man, like, this is like the third consecutive show or whatever, and there's a ton of stuff, or I got to be at a meeting or something.
Yeah.
7 hours, and those people could care less that I was out the night before. So like, just like stress and like, you know, just kind of takes over. But I'm aware, though. I'm aware that like those people, I have a responsibility to those people.
Yeah.
Like I really, really there's two things that trip me out. One, if like a promoter or a club owner books me for their birthday and New Year's, those are always the ones that I'm like, this is like the complete trust. You know what I'm saying? Like, they're giving me the opportunity to supply the entire environment and energy and music for their big night. You know what I mean? Those are like two of the nights. And honestly, it's always someone's birthday. I go into a club, I say, if you're celebrating a birthday, make some noise. It's always 150 people screaming.
No pressure.
Right? So it's like, that's every night. So I'm just aware of the responsibility. So I would say 90% of the time, that is my happiest place. But on those times where I'm like, you know, being normal and human, like, I just remember that. I think about that.
And that keeps you.
You have to.
What's the biggest misconception about your job?
Just that it's like easy. Like, oh, you just play music. You know what I mean? Like, what's so hard about that?
You just drink all day and play music.
Right.
Can I have that job?
Yeah, for sure, right? Can I have that job when we find it? I think that's the biggest misconception, because it's so much that goes into that moment.
Mm-hmm.
So when we go on the air and we are playing music and drinking and partying and setting that vibe,
right?
That like release for people,
mm-hmm.
It's a lot that goes into that. So I think that's the biggest misconception.
What do you have planned for the rest of the year? Like,
yeah, a week from today,
mm-hmm.
we are dropping our annual mixtape, Leaks of the Industry 2015.
Ooh, okay.
So this will be a mixtape that we do every year that is filled with exclusives. You know what I mean? It's mm-hmm. filled with like new music from artists from across the country. It's one of my favorite mixtapes to do because It just signifies a lot. It signifies like relationships.
Mm-hmm.
It signifies artists that we believe in.
Right.
And having the opportunity to give them some type of platform is exactly what LA Leakers is about. So we're putting out that mixtape. We have Hardfest coming up in August, which is going to be really dope, which is Melk and myself's first festival. So that's going to be
first of many.
Mm-hmm. First of many, exactly. So if you are in LA, please come out to Hardfest. That's going to be really dope. And, you know, we dropped Pull Up was our first single we put out at the top of this year.
Love it.
Thank you.
We have a video. Sorry to cut you off, but we have a video. Mm-hmm. Or I took a video of us playing it at the ski lodge.
Oh, yeah?
And we're all just like,
hey. Yeah.
I was going to send it to you, but I was like, is that creepy? So I just kept it for myself.
Well, you sent it to me so I could post it. And thank you for that. So we're getting ready to drop our second single.
Oh,
so,
nice.
Yeah, we're getting ready to drop our second single. So that's really what's like on the agenda for the next few months, is just blowing that up and getting everything right. And then just seeing where the rest of the year takes us.
Dope. And when can people catch you on air?
I'm on every single night from 7 to 10, Monday through Friday, mm-hmm. with Eric Deluxe on Power 106. And also you can hear me Wednesday at 2.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on the new at 2 with Yessi Ortiz once a week, and Wednesday is my day.
Okay, and what are your Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, MySpace?
Yeah, get a pen because all of my social medias are different.
Really?
Yes.
What?
So annoying, right? My Instagram is Justin_Credible. My Snapchat is jcreddy, J-C-R-E-D-D-Y, and my Twitter is J_Credible.
All right. You just like to keep us on our toes. That's all it is.
Yeah, that's all it is. I appreciate you. Thank you so much, though, for having me on
your show. Thank you. I appreciate you.
I've heard a lot of dope stuff about your show. It's an honor to be on it.
Oh, thank you.
For sure. Keep doing your thing, okay?
All right. My name's Jocelyn Vega, and this was Meet the Industry with Justin Credible.
The way you say that. I need that on the radio tonight.
Work. I know you've been waiting all night. It's alright. I know what you wanna get full of. Yeah. I'm about to pull up. You a bad bitch looking for some tough, but I ain't gon' chase, not a hunter. Back then used to pull up in a Honda. Now I'll pull up if it ain't valet. Hood nigga lost in the valet. What you saying? When I pull off, no, these bitches ain't stand. They ain't with me, these niggas just stands. It's an effed up party, tell me where you stand. Cause I know you've been waiting all night. It's alright. You wanna get pulled up, yeah. I'm about to pull up.
Tell them relax that plate. Higher than Cool John in the plane. Smash into the altitude where they start serving drinks in the main cabin. Grew up in the streets. If it ain't action, niggas couldn't go to sleep at night. We need action. 2-2-3, throw a bullet wound. That's a bullet wound. Stretch from a bullet wound. Niggas think they butterfly. I make a coupon. Up from so soon, Federation gun cone.
I know. You've been waiting all night. It's alright. What you wanna get full of, yeah. I'm about to pull up. Pull up. I'm about to pull up.
baller, no practice. Smoking on sherbert, we don't smoke cactus. Pull up anytime, yeah, still will. Living still, tryna ink the kid like ill will. But I'm self-made, self-paid, my nigga. Put my homies on the payroll and pay my niggas. HBK, my nigga, we the wave, my nigga. Brought the whole bay back, we did it. Making no decision, so I decided to get it. So if you looking for me, then you better pull up.
I know, I know, you've been waiting all night,
all night.
It's alright. I know what you wanna get pulled up.
Yeah.
I'm about to pull up.
Hey, what's up? It's Just Incredible right here from Power 106, the liftoff every night from 7 to midnight. LA Leakers, scam artist. You know I'm checking in. I'm right here on Meet the Industry with my homegirl Jocelyn Vega. You already know what time it is. Let's keep it rolling.